Hello, and welcome to this talk about how to produce synthetic minerals. My name is Juan Diego Rodriguez-Blanco, and I am a lecturer at Trinity College Dublin. I would like to start this talk with one question, which is very simple, but at the same time very important, which is why. Why do we need to produce synthetic minerals? So I can give you four main answers. Okay. First thing is that we may need synthetic minerals to use them as standards for our analytical techniques. Sometimes we need synthetic minerals because we need starting material for our experiments. For example, if you want to understand what happens during the interaction of calcite with a solution containing this or that organic, then what you need to use is calcite as a starting material. So therefore you need to produce pure calcite and only calcite. Also, sometimes it is the opposite. Sometimes what you want to do is to obtain these minerals as end products, to understand how they form, to understand the crystallization sequences and kinetics, okay? And to understand also the effect of specific variables or environmental conditions during the crystallization of these minerals. Okay? And as you can imagine, one important application is industry. Okay, industry produces catalysts, specific reagents, and the crystallization of minerals is key for industry. All right. So here, at the very end, what we want is to obtain solids that will have targeted compositions and structures, and that means specific properties. So, okay, is it possible that we can solve this by buying minerals or by getting them from nature? Well, first thing, if you try to buy them in the supermarket, this will not work because these are not really minerals. This is water, okay? So that's not the way. But we can buy minerals. And the problem here is that, yes, we can buy minerals, but the main problem that we find here or when we get them from nature is purity. And I'm going to show you these three examples. So here, I was trying to get pure gypsum. So what can we find here? First example, pure reddish gypsum. Well, if gypsum is red, it's unlikely that it's going to be pure. So therefore, there are likely many more inorganics or organics here or even inclusions. Okay, so this is not pure gypsum. Second example, organic gypsum powder. Well, what is that? Because organic gypsum, I don't know what this is, but if it is gypsum containing organics, these organics on the surface may change the surface properties of these small gypsum crystals. So this gypsum will be different compared to ideal pure gypsum. Third example, selenite, which is gypsum, which are perfect crystals. Well, they look perfect perhaps, but there are some other crystals here which are black. Therefore, there is more than one phase here. There is more than one mineral there. And if you want to use this as a starting material, that can be complicated because you may find more things than gypsum. Okay. So I'm going to summarize now the problem that we are facing with four main questions. First thing, is there any universal recipe to produce synthetic minerals? Well, the answer is no, of course. Why is that? Because obviously there are many minerals in nature, more than 4,500, and each mineral has its own stability field. So one recipe that could be fantastic to produce one mineral could be completely useless to produce another one. Okay? So obviously the answer is no. Second question, is it possible to synthesize any mineral we wish? And here mineral, I mean a solid, which is crystalline, that happens in nature. And the answer, I usually say, is not yet. And why is that? Because if nature is able to produce that mineral, that means that there is a synthesis route. It should be possible to crystallize it. But very often, we don't know how to. Can we synthesize a mineral with a targeted chemistry? Well, sometimes we can do that. For example, if you want to produce pure calcite, pure gypsum, pure apatite, there is no problem. But if you want to add ions, foreign ions in these minerals with different proportion, then the synthesis can be very complicated. And sometimes we don't even know how to do this, right? And the final, the billion-dollar question is it possible to synthesize a mineral with targeted chemistry, a targeted structure, and specific size and shape? And the answer here is complicated, and it can be very complicated. For some minerals, we know how to. For some other ones, we don't even know how to produce any solid. Okay, it's very easy to do that, for example, to produce calcite with some specific chemistry, obviously structure and size and shape. But if you want to play with more complex minerals or more less common minerals in nature, that can be very complicated. And why is this? Because there are many variables affecting crystallization and also many variables that affect the properties of crystals, okay, of minerals. For example, typical variables. If we have foreign ions in the structure of crystals, that will affect the properties. For example, in calcite, it's very common to find magnesium or strontium, and these ions can affect the solubility product and the dissolution rate of calcite. Okay. Also, ions adsorbed on mineral surface can affect quite a lot the surface properties of these minerals. For example, typical thing that happens is that the synthesis of calcite, the industrial synthesis of calcite, is done by using organics, which avoid the caking effect, avoid that calcite forms clumps. Okay, but these organics affect the dissolution rate and the solubility of calcite. All right. Also, sometimes we have problems because we have crystalline inclusions. It's very common that we have salts in minerals in nature or non-fully dissolved reagents when we produce them in the laboratory, and that affects the properties. Okay, for example, it's very common to find halite associated with gypsum, for example. Okay, also, structural defects. Sometimes we can produce minerals, but the problem is that they have very tiny crystallite size, and this can be a problem when we are trying to target some specific properties. Okay, sometimes we have problems because the minerals can have twinning. And imagine if you are producing one mineral that will have specific properties for optical devices, you don't want to have twinning. Okay. Another example, particle size. As you know, nanominerals have very high surface area per gram compared to micro or bigger minerals, and therefore different thermodynamic properties. So sometimes producing nanominerals can be a problem. Polymorphism. Sometimes what happens is that we try to produce only one polymorph and we end up with two or three. Very commonly, if we try to produce calcite, you may get, yes, 99% of calcite, but 1% of aragonite or baterite or something else. Okay, and we don't want that in some cases. So all these variables affect the properties of our product, and therefore they are going to affect the experimental results, the analysis, if you are using them in the laboratory. So now, I'm going to give you a quick overview of typical crystallization methods we use in the laboratory. And these are methods that people in my group use quite a lot. For example, crystallization from solution is very easy. And what you have is two solutions made of ions or compounds, reagents, which are quite soluble. And when you mix them, you produce a solid which is more insoluble. For example, here you have a solution containing sodium carbonate, which is mixed with a solution containing calcium chloride to make calcium carbonate, calcite, for example. Okay, so we mix these solutions, then we use vacuum filtration to get rid of the water, and sometimes we use some organics to get rid of the interstitial water. So at the end, we have a powder, a solid. Sometimes what we do is solid-state crystallization. And we do this by mixing the reagents in a crucible like this, a small crucible, and we put this crucible inside a furnace at high temperature, okay? For example, 1,000 degrees C or even higher. What will happen is that these reagents will melt, and when we cool down the furnace, solids will crystallize. Another method, which is very beautiful, is hydrothermal synthesis. In this case, what we do is we mix aqueous solutions, usually at ambient temperature, in reactors, which are made of Teflon, and these reactors can withstand temperatures of 200, 220 degrees C. So we put these reactors inside hydrothermal cells. The temperature is increased to 200 degrees or 220, and what will happen is that crystallization will take place inside this fluid. okay? And then you can take these crystals for analysis or for whatever purpose. Okay, things that we need to consider here is that, okay, usually when we mix solutions, they should be not very hot. It's not complicated, sorry, it's not easy to mix hot solutions. So we usually mix solutions at ambient temperatures or at temperatures which are below 80 degrees C. Second thing is that, yes, some reactors can allow also gas. For example, if you want to use supercritical CO2, you can have a reactor with an inlet that will input CO2 there at high pressure, okay, and high temperature. Also, sometimes there are reactors that have been developed to mix hot solutions, but usually the method is by mixing very small volumes of solution. That can be done at temperatures which are not extremely high, 200 or 300 degrees C. And also, as you can imagine, these reactors cannot be opened during the experiment. To take samples, what I mean is that you only get one sample, usually, which is the final sample. If you are operating these reactors at 200 degrees C, it's not easy to open them because you have to cool down, then take the sample, warm up them again, and the problem is that the experiment could give you unexpected results. So what we usually do is we mix the solutions and we open the reactors after having them at high temperature, the sample is considered as final. Okay, so if you want to carry out experiment by taking different samples as a function of time, what you have to do here is to prepare several reactors and take each one of them at different elapsed times. Okay, another method, which is very common, is to carry out mineral water interaction processes. So here, for example, what you do is to interact solutions with ions or organics with minerals. Okay, and you can do this at ambient temperature or hydrothermally. So what happens here? So there are different processes that may happen. For example, what usually happens is that you have diffusion of ions from the aqueous solution inside the host mineral. Also, you can have surface precipitation, okay? And in some cases, you can even have full replacement reactions. Another method, for example, which is quite elegant, is the crystallization in gels. So what do you do here? So what you have is a specific reactor that has a gel in the middle part, and this gel is a hydrated porous network, which is nearly 99% of water. And what happens here is that you have a solution at the bottom, another one at the top, and the ions from the solution, they are going to diffuse through the gel, and when they combine, they will start nucleating crystals. So this is an ideal method to produce single crystals. It's a very beautiful method, but the problem is that sometimes these processes can be very slow. Crystallization can take place in a matter of weeks or even months. And then there are typical methods that we have even studied at high school, like, for example, evaporation or slow cooling and so on. So now I'm going to show you three examples to explain you how complex this process can be. So I'm going to start with a sample which is about calcite. What happens if you need pure calcite for your experiments? Well, the first thing that you may think, well, it's very simple. The only thing I have to do is to get a solution containing sodium carbonate, another one containing calcium chloride, and mix them. And yes, you are going to produce pure calcite, but you are going to see now what potential outcomes you may have. So I'm going to show you one graph in which what you will see is how to produce pure calcite only taking into account three variables. The most important one, supersaturation, and also you will see some variations in pH and in temperatures. Okay, so first thing, supersaturation. Okay, you can play at low or high supersaturation conditions. This is low or high starting concentrations, and the results are going to be completely different. So when you start at low supersaturations, if you mix the solutions, you can mix them gradually, let's say drop by drop, or instantaneously, in a matter of less than 1 second, let's say. Okay, so the outcome could be slightly different. So because in the first case, you have a slow growth of calcite by a constant addition of solution, and you're growing calcite layer by layer very slowly, producing perfect ideal crystals. The second one can give you smaller crystals, Okay, they are going to be calcite, but they are less perfect compared to slow growth. Okay, but this is solution going to calcite directly. What happens if we increase the supersaturation, the starting concentration? So what will happen is that we form an amorphous phase. This amorphous phase is calcium carbonate. It's a hydrated phase, which is not crystalline. It's disordered. And what happens here is that, okay, you can take this amorphous phase, separate it from water, and crystallize it by a solid state. No problem about that. But also, if you leave this in water, this amorphous phase is metastable. It will survive for a couple of minutes, and then it will crystallize as calcite via one process named spherotic growth. Okay, and here you will form calcite crystals, but these calcite crystals will have a morphology which is completely different to the previous ones, and I will show you some pictures very soon. What happens if you increase the supersaturation even more? What will happen is that you will produce calcite, but that will occur via the crystallization of metastable phases, like, for example, aragonite at high temperature, baterite at ambient temperature, and ikeite at very low, less than 5 degrees C temperature. Okay, these phases, they are all calcium carbonate, but they are metastable. They form very quickly via spherotic growth, forming spherules, okay, and then they transform into calcite, usually via dissolution and recrystallization. So they slowly dissolve and recrystallize as calcite. Well, there is one exception, which is ikeite, that sometimes can transform into calcite via solid state transformation. Okay, but what you have here is a big picture in which at the end you only have calcite, but all these calcites are completely different. And I'm going to show you now the pictures, some examples. Okay, here you have calcite, four pictures, all of them showing only calcium carbonate. Only calcite. The first one is by a baterite. The second one is from amorphous calcium carbonate directly. The third one is the solid state transformation from amorphous calcium carbonate. And the fourth one is via spherotic growth at cold temperature. Okay. So what is happening here? Yes, you have the same composition and structure. All is calcium carbonate, all is calcite. But because of these different sizes and shapes, these minerals will have different solubilities, different dissolution rates, different crystallite size, and different surface areas. That means that if you don't know what you are producing, if you don't control your crystallization mechanism, then you may end up with very different types of calcite. And that will be translated into different results, different analytical results, different outcomes in your experiments. And if you don't know why this is happening, that's going to be a problem for you. Okay, so therefore, you always need to control very well the supersaturation and the environmental conditions to produce always the desired calcite crystals that you need. Okay, now another example. I need pure dolomite for my experiments. Okay, so dolomite is a calcium-magnesium carbonate with this formula here. And in the case of dolomite, you could envision, all right, that should not be very complicated, because what I can do is to mix a sodium carbonate solution with another solution containing magnesium chloride and calcium chloride. Well, that is in theory very simple, but you're going to see how complicated it is, because there are many variables to consider here. First thing is the chemical variable. Okay, if we have a system containing calcium, magnesium carbonate, and water only, no other ions, and we form these carbonates, by mixing solutions via amorphous phases, you will see that the outcomes are going to be very different. So I'm going to show you what happens when we have only calcium, only magnesium, and different contents or different ratios of calcium, magnesium in your aqueous solution. Okay, so this corresponds to your aqueous solution. Okay, in the case of only calcium, you know what happens. You have seen that before. So we can produce calcite, but that may happen directly or via different polymorphs. Okay, when we have a small amount of magnesium, we are going to produce a type of minerals which are named the magnesium calcites. And I'm saying this in plural. It is magnesium calcites because this is calcite that can incorporate variable amounts of magnesium. And this depends on supersaturation and the ratio of calcium and magnesium in the starting solution. Okay. Now, when we have a higher content of magnesium, but still smaller than calcium in solution, you will start forming monohydrocalcite. And we should say monohydrocalcites because this mineral can have variable amount of magnesium, also depending on supersaturation and calcium-magnesium ratio in the starting solution. It is hydrated and metastable. It will transform with time and also temperature into aragonite. Okay? Then, what happens when we have the same amount of calcium and magnesium in our system? What will happen at ambient temperature is that we are going to form monohydrocalcite again. But if we increase the temperature, we will start forming dolomite at temperatures higher than 60 degrees C. Okay. Then, when we have only magnesium, we will produce magnesium carbonates. But the problem here is that, okay, you can see here the magnesium carbonates, but if we are playing with calcium equal magnesium in our aqueous solutions and we want to produce dolomite, this red line is very thin. And what I mean with this is that if we go slightly to the left or to the right, we may produce dolomite that also contains some other polymer or some other minerals, magnesium carbonates. So we may find that our end product is 99% of dolomite, 1% of hydromagnesite or neskyonite. So therefore, we don't have a pure phase. So finding the thin line here can be complicated because at the very beginning you don't have this chart. Okay, you start from scratch. Right? This is first thing, the chemistry. Now, the structure. There are different types of dolomites. Sometimes some dolomite can contain a little bit of calcium more than magnesium. Sometimes they contain the same amount. But one thing which is very important is the degree of ordering. So this represents ordered dolomite. In this case, what you can see here is that dolomite consists of polyhedra, octahedra containing calcium, magnesium, and these polyhedra are bonded by the carbonate groups. Okay? This representation here shows ordered dolomite. So it is ordered because you have bands with only calcium, only magnesium, only calcium, only magnesium, and so on. But dolomite can also be disordered. That means that sometimes you can have disordered in this calcium magnesium. You can have random ordering here. And that's translated into different properties of dolomite. Different stability, that means different solubility product, and also different dissolution rate. And sometimes you have slightly more calcium than magnesium. Therefore, all this is going to affect the properties of dolomite. So therefore, what you need to find is one synthesis method which is ideal to produce ordered dolomite that contains the same calcium and magnesium ratio. And that usually depends on temperature. You need to use high temperature, and you need to prepare your solutions, your starting solutions, very well. Okay? And you also need to wait the right amount of time. Another thing is that when you produce dolomite, when you produce this mineral from amorphous phases, you usually get crystals like this. And these are not single crystals. This is spheroidic growth. What happens is that you have this kind of aggregates made of nanoparticles. And obviously, the properties of these crystals in terms of solubility and dissolution rate will not be the same as classic big micrometric dolomite. You can produce micrometric dolomite by using a different system. For example, by mixing magnesium-rich solutions with calcite and increasing temperature, doing this at hydrothermal conditions. Okay? The problem here is that first you need pure calcite, and this will be translated into the crystallization of bigger dolomite crystals that will have different properties compared to this spheroidic dolomite. Okay? So here there are two things. First thing is that you need to find out how to make this. Second thing is that you need to have pure calcite if you want to have, at the end, pure dolomite. if you are using calcium that contains some strontium or some barium or some other ions, then this dolomite may not be pure dolomite. Okay, so as you have seen, there are three main variables here: the composition of your aqueous solution, the chemical variable, the structural variable, the order and disorder of dolomite, and the morphology variable that can be translated into very different properties. Okay. Now, example three. I need bastnaesite to determine its solubility product. Okay, what is bastnaesite? Bastnaesite is a rare earth carbonate. It is one of the most important sources of rare earth elements for industry. Okay, bastnaesite is a mineral that can be found in nature, and the problem here is that one colleague told me, okay, I need to get some bastnaesite to do calculations, do experiments to determine the solubility product. And in this case, this person wanted two types of bastnaesite: lanthanum bastnaesite and neodymium bastnaesite. And well, you could think perhaps we can do one thing, to buy this. Okay, and what happens if we try to buy bastnaesite? That you can buy bastnaesite, of course. But these bastnaesites here, they are not going to be pure at all. They will have lanthanum and neodymium and everything else. Bastnaesite is a mineral which consists of a very complex solid solution. Therefore, you can find all the rare earth elements there, and therefore that means that the properties of this complex bastnaesite will not be the same as the pure bastnaesite containing only one or two rare earth elements. Okay, so the only way of playing with bastnaesite is by synthesizing it, and the synthesis route has to be very precise. How could we do this? Well, again, what we can do is to have solutions containing sodium carbonate and mix these solutions with rare earth element solutions, for example, a lanthanum solution or a neodymium solution. Okay, and what do we get at the end? Okay, let's see. So the first thing that happens is that we don't get directly bastnaesite from solution. What I mean is that bastnaesite, this mineral, forms via an amorphous phase. This amorphous phase is a rare earth carbonate which is hydrated that transforms into bastnaesite via different polymorphs. Okay, so there is a complex crystallization sequence here that involves hydrated polymorphs that gradually dehydrate. But also the problem here is that this crystallization pathway can change depending on temperature and depending on the rare earth element involved. So when you don't have any information about this, you need to find out what is the best method to produce bastnaesite. And it happens that for the lanthanum bastnaesite, you need to play at different temperatures compared to neodymium bastnaesite. Okay, and sometimes you can jump over some of these polymorphs and form directly bastnaesite from solution, but you need to play at different temperatures depending on the composition of this solid. Okay, also temperatures. There is another variable here that I wanted to introduce, which is the temperature ramp. It's not the same if your oven is preheated at, for example, 220 degrees C, or if you put the experiment and then you heat up the oven. The result can be completely different. And here you can see one example. Here you see all these minerals here in these pictures are bastnaesite. It's the same mineral, pure neodymium bastnaesite, the same composition, the same structure. But the morphology of all these crystals is different. And why is that? Because they were synthesized with preheated ovens or non-preheated ovens. Sometimes the oven was preheated at 200 degrees C, sometimes at 165. Sometimes we put the experiment at ambient temperature and then we heat up the oven. Okay, so the end product is going to be completely different, and this will depend on the thermal ramp. And why is that? Because, as I told you, crystallization of bastnaesite happens via an amorphous phase. So the crystallization pathway will depend on the dehydration of this amorphous phase, the breakdown of this phase. And the morphology of the product will depend on how fast this amorphous phase breaks down. Okay, it will not be the same if it takes hours or minutes to break down. So therefore, depending on that, you can form bastnaesite, which are micrometric crystals or nanometric crystals or aggregates with very different shapes. Okay? So that is only controlled by the thermal ramp. So you need to know very well what conditions you produce your crystals in order to obtain always the same solids with the properties you want and the sizes you want. I'm giving you some other examples and ideas very quickly. Hematite. This is a mineral that can be easily produced, but the production depends on temperature. The properties depend on temperature. You can produce hematite at 300, 600, 1000 degrees C, but the properties of hematite will be different compared to the synthesis temperature because of one important parameter, which is the crystallite size. So what is particle size and crystallite size? Okay, particle size is the size of our particles. I mean, the size we can measure with a scale bar in our images, okay? The crystallite size is a different concept. That's the size of the ordered domains inside your particle. What I mean with this is that a particle can be made of one crystallite or several ones. So the size of these ordered domains, this is what is the crystallite size. Okay? So I'm showing you here what happens, for example, when we synthesize hematite at 600 degrees C. You get particles that are nanometric, that could be 50 nanometers, and each particle consists of one crystallite, okay? There are no domains here. It is only one crystal. Each particle is one crystal. But if you produce this same mineral at 1000 degrees C, yes, these particles are bigger. They are bigger than 500 nanometers and even reaching the micrometer size sometimes. But if you focus on the structure at the nanoscale, what you will see is that these particles consist of different domains. This is where you can see the crystallite size. These are the ordered domains of these particles. And depending on what you get, one crystallite per particle or several, the magnetic or electric properties of this mineral could be completely different. And this is only a matter of hitting a thermal ramp and maximum temperature reads. Other things, for example, stirring. Stirring that can be something which we don't care about can be crucial sometimes for the production of some calcium carbonate polymorphs. So here what you see is a diagram showing you different morphologies of calcium carbonate polymorphs like batterite, calcite, aragonite, and it's not the same if you shake the experiment very slowly or very quickly. In this case, we're producing calcium carbonate in the presence of alcohols. And the top ones happened when we were shaking the solutions very quickly and the bottom ones very slowly. So you can see that the morphologies and even the polymorphs can be completely different depending only on shaking. Okay? Some other things, for example, if you are doing experiments using chambers, to, for example, because you need to deal with anaerobic reactions or when you need to produce deuterated solids, that can be complicated because if the chamber has any leak, even if it is a small leak, that can be translated into the crystallization of different polymorphs, into the changes in composition, in morphology, and many more things. So this is one variable more to add to the previous ones. So at the end, what I want to summarize is that there is a very important take-home message to consider. Okay, as you know, there are many methods to produce synthetic minerals, but you can imagine there is a huge gap of knowledge in this. Okay, but the important thing is that if you need to obtain a synthetic mineral, you need to control very, very well all the variables that affect crystallization. If you don't control one or several of these variables, you may end up with different solids, with different polymorphs, with different sizes, with different properties at the end. Okay? And if you don't know how you are doing this, then what will happen is that you will not understand why you have some variations in your experimental results. Therefore, you need to know very well which are your variables, which are affecting crystallization, and to control them in order to crystallize minerals with targeted structure, composition, and size. So, well, thank you very much for this for your attendance, and also thank you very much to the European Association of Geochemistry for inviting me to give this talk.